McGuinn had a vision, and it turned out to be, "Will the Circle Be Unbroken?" I had an idea about it. I thought that Maybell would be singing a song I wrote, and that we'd get Doc Watson in there with an electric Telecaster and a wah-wah pedal and whatever other tricks we had. I thought, well, we'll make these country aristocrats play our kind of country rock music. Luckily, they didn't. Luckily, my vision didn't come to be. So instead, we got there and we learned humility. The first album I ever made with the Dirt Band was Uncle Charlie and His Dog Teddy, and it had a Mr. Bojangles on it. And I thought, hey, this is easy. Every time you go into the studio, it's like this. And I became very proud of. I became brazen in meeting Maybelle Carter and Jimmy Martin and Earl Scruggs and Roy Acuff. It taught me humility.
Roy Acuff had this thing that sort of got him through it, is he imagined us without our beards and long hair. So we became real easy to talk to, and it's really after we played some of the music, it became evident to him that we weren't down here to make fun of this stuff. We were serious about it. We didn't come down here for some goofy reason. It was like, this is the music that we loved. We just looked the way we did.
I'm very happy that we actually made up our minds to do this project. We've been very reluctant to do it because of all the other sequels. I mean, we live in a world of sequels, and consequently, they're all judged by the standards that the first one set. This album is not the same as the first album. This album is The Circle in 1989. Hopefully everybody will enjoy the music as much as they did on the first one. That's the idea. It's not so much the fact that the first album had a group of people on it. It was the spirit that the group of people brought to the record. And hopefully the group that we have assembled here to do this project will bring the same thing to this album, and then it will be conveyed to the listener.
Being familiar with the first one and knowing we were going to do the second one, I was really excited to see what the experience would be of actually recording live and having that intensity and that focus, and actually wondering how anybody could ever get a bunch of people together in a studio and get a whole song done and mixed live to two-track in one day, because never having made a record like that and knowing some of the pains that we go through, you know, when we make records and other people do, I was sort of skeptical that it could ever, that actually really happened, you know, and I must say that this has exceeded all my expectations.
I was standing by my window on one cold and cloudy day when I saw the hearse come rolling far to carry my mother away. Will the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a
It was one of my favorite records as a kid. My younger brother John was a bluegrass fan, and he turned me on to this Will the Circle Be Unbroken record. And I loved it. We went to see the Dirt Band play live in Williamsburg, Virginia, where I'm from. And it was just something that meant a lot to me. It was really one of the most, if not the most enjoyable record that I've ever done, including my two records that our band's made, because it was all live. It wasn't the typical tedious studio process where you just nitpick everything and just consider everything and listen to the song, you know, countless times. You can really lose your perspective that way. This way was just 10 guys in a room playing all live and no overdubs allowed.
Well, no one was looking on the old plantation. They took her all the way down the Long Valley Road. They sent her away not too much later.
think anyone who listens to our track can tell that we were having a good time. It was a breakneck tempo. You can hear everyone yelling at the end. They left that on there. You can hear everyone sort of yelling like, amazing, we got through this.
Yeah, one thing that these Circle albums, both of them, have done marvelously, I think, is bring two different sides, or three or four different sides of the musical spectrum together. To see an album that has Bruce Hornsby, who's got great pop appeal, on an album with Jimmy Martin, who's a bluegrass legend. Yeah, you don't see that just every day.
The Newgrass Revival, to me, is really the epitome of the traditional bluegrass brought into the 80s and, you know, and approaching the 90s. Those guys are just, they're amazing. I love, they do stuff like a bluegrass version of Ain't That Peculiar, you know? I mean, they got, it's like, it's sort of like Sam and Dave meets Flat and Scruggs.
Did you hear Jerusalem on?
Bluegrass. They should take everything, just all Leon songs, and just play them just as fast as they could. and it was a scream to me. I loved it.
Everyone has enjoyed their cult acceptance, but I think in 1989, that'll be the year that Newgrass Revival will have their first big country hit. A lot more people will start to realize who they are.
Expected it when I bought the first record that I would be playing on the second.
You know, one of the more interesting aspects about doing a live recording is that everybody works and plays together at the same time. When the machine is running, you know, you've got guys playing guitars, myself back there playing the drums, you've got any number of great vocalists out there, and the last thing you want to do is make a mistake. Because if you make a mistake, you start it all over again. So you work to get a performance as a whole, and when you're done, it's a very satisfying experience.
Oh, lost river, now I'm coming back to the pot-bellied stove where the firewood's all stacked. Huckleberry girl, go with me. I'm a bell in the flood to lead where the lost river
together these hippies from California, us, long-haired and against the war and playing electric guitars and real loud drums with a bunch of Nashville's aristocracy. And in this case, some of the same folks, some of their children are joined together with some of the current pop stars and people from different sides of the music scene. But they all have one thing in common, I guess, is a deep abiding love of acoustic music. A tradition. They have a reverence for tradition.
I think the sterling example is Ralph Emery's reaction to our song, You Ain't Going Nowhere, which we took to WSM and asked him to play it on the air for us. And he previewed it on a turntable, and he said he wouldn't play it because he asked me what it's about. And I said, I don't know, it's a Bob Dylan song, and I've always had a hard time figuring out what Bob Dylan songs are about. You know?
But now, 1989, of course, what is considered country music. If the Grateful Dead were a brand new group right now, they'd be country band.
Right.
And so things do go around.
Machines and made a 16 track out of it. That was the first time.
But we cut down here in Nashville, Sweetheart of the Rodeo. We did two 8-track machines then.
Yeah, that's what we did.
So what do you think of this new thing of cutting a song in one day? When was the last time you did that?
Well, you know, they used to do that 30 years ago. It's the only way they could do it. I like it. I like the spun.
That's the Frank Sinatra approach.
Well,
really?
What's the point? The idea of making records is capture that
get the music
energy on the vinyl, on the tape.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's the hardest part, is capturing that energy you put out on a live performance on tape.
So this was something you wanted to do?
I would love to do this all the time myself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We were only 15 years old when we did that, remember?
That's right. 12. I was 12.
Yeah, that's right. 2 8-track machines.
The only complaint I have about this project is that it's too concentrated. It's like I wake up in the morning and I just lay in bed for an hour trying to think about what has come the day before and trying to really enjoy it while I'm here, because it's going to be over so fast. And you never have time to really reflect on what's come down the day before, because you're working, you're home, you go to sleep, you come back, and all of a sudden the whole process starts all over again with a new artist. It's like coming downstairs on Christmas morning for four straight weeks. You never get to enjoy the toys you just opened because you're onto something else, you know. And I know it's going to be over real soon here, and years from now I want to think back and go, I can't believe it really happened. So I just want to try to enjoy it while I'm here, you know, which is hard to find the time to do that.
I must have been 10 or 11 when I cut that album. My mom got it for me for Christmas.
And I could say that that album singly by itself would probably be the reason why I'm still playing. That's how much it influenced me.
Does it still?
Yeah, I mean, I remember just memories from it, you know. It's like I hadn't heard it maybe in several years, and but it's almost like that's what I think about when I play this kind of music. I think about Vassar, and I think about all the dialogue and Doc meeting Merle Travis for the first time, you know. It was bigger than life.
At Randy Scruggs, bless his heart, he said, "We picked out a song for you, Jimmy." And I said, "What is it?" He said, "Setting on Top of the World." I said, "Well, if I record it, Randy, which he's a producer," and I said, "If I get to record that, I guess, Randy, you and the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band and your daddy, Earl Scruggs, and Roy Acuff, and Emmylou Harris, and Ricky Skaggs, they'll just help me set on top of the world, I guess." And I appreciate it. During the session of, I was singing Setting on Top of the World, and I must have missed it 14 times. Every time he'd take a break on his dobro, I'd get to listen to him so good, and I'd forget coming in, forget when to come in, forget my part. Lord, I'm setting on. Lord, I'm setting on. A little quicker on you, setting on. Lord, I'm setting on top of the world.
Chance to throw a name in the hat, and my choice was Levon Helm, a singer, a drummer, somebody who influenced me tremendously, and a totally believable character. An actor, what can I say, a wild and crazy guy. When Levon said, let's go do the track, that's what we did. Later on that evening, he said, let's party, and that's what we did.
When I get my reward,
section of people, Johnny Cash and Jimmy Martin and Bruce Hornsby. Yeah, all of them being on the same record at the same time. It's pretty wild idea, you know, if you think about it. You know, those same people were here in this room and we were here with them and get to play on this record. It's really an honor.
How do you feel about playing with Mark?
Oh, well, Mark's all right, you know.
We've done this before.
We do this a lot. It seems like we end up on records together a lot. And I love it. He's the best musician I've ever heard, I've ever played with. And,
nah.
Yeah.
Now, see, when sometimes I'll be sitting here, and I've seen Jerry play a lot, you know, we've been
different places in the world and everything, and sometimes I'll go over and I'll look at it and I go, man, how's he doing that? Unbelievable.
Sorry. In my thoughts of yesterday, where friends and family gathered for the Lord. There an old-fashioned preacher taught the straight and narrow way for what few coins a congregation could afford. Dressed in all our Sunday best, we sit on pews of solid oak, and I remember how our voices filled the air. Mama sounded like an angel on those high soprano notes, and when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Looking back now, that little mountain church house has become my life's cornerstone. It was there in that little mountain church house I first heard the word I based my life upon.
Perfect for our voices to blend together on this song. Chuck had always liked Lovin' on the Side. But when Paulette got down here and started singing it, she had some real problems with some of the chauvinism in the lyric. And so we got together at Vanderbilt Plaza one night and kicked around the lyric, and kind of, she co-wrote it with us. And made it fit her perfectly. And we thought we had agreed on it, and the next day she came into the studio and it was still too chauvinistic. But she, what she's done is she's really updated this old song, 15-year-old song, and she, I love the way she sings. Love it on the side.
So what were the chauvinistic lyrics that you did?
I said the bitch has got to die.
As I recall, I had some of the lines I felt needed to be changed just a little bit for me to really get into it, right? Did I give you a hard time on that one?
No, I think you did a wonderful job. I feel you really got into the vocal. You did a great job, and those lyrical changes you made were needed.
Well, thank you very much.
I give him a hard time right now.
Yeah, I could give him a hard time. Yeah, what did you mean when you wrote that song?
She's the one who's feeling happy. I'm the one who wants to die. I think you've gone just a little too far this time. So I just want to clear the air. I already know, darling, I still care. But we're hurting from your loving on the side. I'm not saying that I approve or that I can stand it, but I know I've got to give us one more try. I keep praying you still love me, but soon my prayer will die. If every time we talk you hide your eyes.
Trying to change anything that's going on as it is, just kind of overseeing it and kind of giving some guidance and direction, you know, when it's needed. But with the type caliber of musicians and singers that are being on this album, you know, yeah, it makes it so much easier.
Okay. Just Jerry do a tag by himself.
Okay. All right. So like, all right, sure. All right.
What did I just get elected to do?
No, you're gonna put actually a third ending, but you'll be all alone. Gonna go.
After the second shave and a haircut. And then it's just you.
That sounds like a personal problem.
Let us all leave and you're the door slammer and you play something.
Okay.
Let's try
that. Sounds like a live deal with me.
Let's do the first half here.
That's my first idea of the day.
Well, it was a good one.
That's my first problem. What am I tired now?
That's a personal problem.
Prine's name has been in the discussions for this project since the very beginning, because as I said, he's kind of like he continues that tradition of the sort of strolling minstrel with his guitar, singer songwriter, but John's got. He's got that element of which Bob Dylan kind of before John had is that continuing in that tradition of Woody Guthrie and Jimmy Rogers, that songwriter that sees stuff and he can talk about serious things in a humorous way and humorous things in a serious way. And John's really witty, and I've always been just real impressed with his ability as a writer. Plus, he seems to have such a good time when he's playing the guitar and singing. that it's infectious. It's really easy to pick up on that.
Well, Grandpa wore his suit to dinner nearly every day. No particular reason, he just dressed that way. Brown necktie and a matching vest, both in wingtip shoes. He built a closet on our back porch and put a penny in a burned-out fuse. Grandpa was a carpenter, built houses, stores, and banks. Chain smoke, chemicals, cigarettes, and hammered nails and planks. He would have leveled on a level, he shaved even every door. And what that rising hour called a liquor one to war. Well, he used to sing me Blood on the Saddle and rock me on his knee. Let me listen to the radio before we got TV. Well, he'd drive to church on Sunday, and he'd take me with him too. Stained glass in every window, period aids in every pew. Grandpa was a carpenter, built houses, stores, and banks. Chain smoke, chemicals, cigarettes, hammered nails and planks. He would have leveled on the level, he shaved even every door. And go to that rising hour, call the liquor. When the war. Well, my grandma was a teacher. She went to school in Bowling Green, trading in a milk and cow for a Singer sewing machine. I wish she called her husband Mister, and she walked real tall and proud. She used to buy me comic books after Grandpa died. Grandpa was a carpenter, he built houses, stores, and banks. Chain smoke, chemicals, cigarettes, and hammered nails and planks. He was a level on the level, he shaved even every door. And put it for hours and hours, called the liquor one to war.
Performance is going to be what's going to hit the wax or hit the CD or hit the cassette tape. It makes everyone in the studio much more aware of what they're doing. It's not, oh, we'll get it in the mix or we'll come in next week and record it. It's funny to watch the boys in the band keep their health a little bit higher, make sure that they're not staying up late, because you can't cover your butt by coming in, you know, 2 weeks later. If you get a cold or if you get hoarse, you're through. You're not going to be able to work that day.
Well, if you don't shake it up first, you just get all the alcohol.
All right.
Spritz it. No, I'm just kidding. There's no alcohol here.
I'm pious.
Yeah, do it again, Rosanne.
I always overdo it.
Of course.
Yeah. Everybody does. This is like
that
thing. Well, that's it. This is like, well, I used the product and I lost weight. You see those things late at night? Totally. Have those big halls full of people that are going, giving the award for the most pounds and stuff. Oh, man, I love it.
I lost weight, my sex life's better, and it does the dishes, too.
I had the first. What did you start doing football there?
Let's try it once. Like,
I'm in fine shape.
Oh, hi. I'm Bob Carpenter from the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band, and when I'm working on a project like Circle 2 and I get my health all fouled up and I can't sing anymore and I lose my voice and I'm hoarse, I just reach for this new lyric. Just like this, brings my voice right back. So remember, if your voice is hurting and you can't sing, just grab a bottle. and it'll bring your voice right back. 9 out of 10 doctors recommend it. Thank you.
It's real cool for lots of reasons, but one of them being that Rosanne has recorded a couple of John's tunes. One of them was a big country hit called This Is the Way We Make a Broken Heart, and they've never done a duet on an album together. So this is a first, one of the first on this album. And John, I personally am a real big fan of his. I've been lucky enough to see him play live a lot, and he's a very energetic guy, which I think you'll see and hear when we get to him.
Let's try one more time from the top.
One step over is a good answer, or, you know, one step over.
We'll step over.
We'll step over.
Ooh, baby, baby.
Give me one step. Give me one step. Give me one step.
God, that's original.
That's the baby.
Oh, step up. Give me one step. Got to step up.
Step up to this.
Step up to this.
I got you one step right here.
I got you one step in, babe.
Let's go one step over the line. I could be a driving wheel. We could make those tires squeal. Ooh, I like the way it feels. Taking it one step over the line.
One step forward and two steps back. It's for the birds now.
One step.
life, at your profession, and there's certain points where you go, this isn't worth it, being away from the family, being on the tour bus, and you get these little treats. You get, oh, geez, you get to hear the song you wrote on the radio for the first time, and that's thrilling, and you get to hear yourself sing, and you get people to stand up and clap, and there's all these little rewards and satisfactions, but this, for me, it's going to be hard to top this one. To me, this is worth a lifetime of, gee, I wish I was home with the family. Gee, I hate sleeping in this bed and this food. All those little things that you put up with in your career and all those doubts that you have and you come back, it's this project especially makes that all worthwhile.
I'm extremely proud of, you know, what I've been able to do. You know, going into it, you wonder, you know exactly what, you know, the outcome of that type of a project would be, but it's really special.
You guys cut a couple of good songs in there.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
A mansion on a hill is a lovely sight to see. Like any other house, it's only temporary. Home is anywhere you choose to put your heart. There's no love inside, it will soon fall apart. Ashes to ashes, dust into dust. Palaces will crumble, bridges will rust. Mountains will disappear, rivers will dry up. So it goes for everything but love.
So it goes,
everything but love.
So it goes.
It's truly live, and I really like that a lot. We sat down and we did it until we got the take we wanted. And that had to do with everybody really feeling it together and being happy with what we got. And it was surprisingly easy, a real experience of breathing together, which I like. Had an enormous amount of fun.
Ashes to ashes, dust into dust. Kingdoms will crumble, bridges will rust. Mountains will disappear, rivers will dry up. So it goes for everything but love.
So it goes,
everything but love.
So it goes,
everything but love.
So it goes,
everything but love.
On Circle 2, we have two kids, Jerry Douglas and Mark O'Connor, who were in high school. I think maybe Jerry was in junior high school when the first album came out. And they say that their careers were definitely bent, if not influenced, by Will the Circle Be Unbroken Part 1. It's great to see them 17 years after the fact then sitting in the circle and being able to contribute. Mark plays for everyone in Nashville, and yet every morning when he comes to work, he seems to be really proud to be part of this album. And of course, the marvelous music that he exhibits every day is proof of that.
You know, when we cut the first Circle album, we were awfully young, and I guess we were a little ragged as musicians, but there was one person there in the studio all the time that kept us together and really kept the bottom end together especially, and that was Junior Husky. And with his passing after the recording of the last album, it's been wonderful to see his son, Roy, carry on, and it's been even more of a thrill to have him in the studio on this album. And it's really important to me as a drummer to have a solid bass player in there working with you. And that guy never missed a lick. What a guy, Junior.
I looked at the record cover of the first Circle album,
And there was a picture of Roy's father in there. And it looks just like Roy with glasses on. It's really spooky, and it's the same bass. It's a lot of things are the same about those two. It's like a clone.
What about the plan?
Wonderful plan.
Yeah.
He's
you just can't get any solid, more solid than that.
He's a state-of-the-art country upright bass player.
It's something I just do. I've had more people ask, how'd you do that? And I don't even know what I did. And if I know what I did, I usually commit loss of how I did it.
The most fun we've had on this album yet would be when Jimmy Martin showed up during Ricky Skaggs' session. Gave us all kind of a raccoon souvenirs. And, yeah, Jimmy's fun.
Take this warning.
No.
Don't let old Satan hold your hand. You'd be lost in sin forever. You'd never reach the promised land. The old crossroads now is waiting. Which one are you gonna take? One leads down through destruction.
With Dad being a part of the project and Johnny Cash, the Carter family, and along with Emmylou Harris and Ricky Skaggs and people like that, I mean, it's real special because, again, those are the Cash and Carters and all that were people that, when I was 6 years old, the first instrument I ever played was all the harp, and Mother Maybell Carter brought over an all the harp for me to play and everything, so I grew up, you know, with that, with those people, and they were not only people I admired for their musicianship and everything, but they were actually family.
Do y'all want us to scoot in like we did, or just jump in like old brother Clyde Moody?
Hey, do we have that on tape?
I run out of air there on that last repeat. I ran out of air, but I left the whole air. I'll get it this time.
That sounded great. Yeah.
Oh, you want to take two instrumentals?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, good. Okay. Then do the chorus again. Yeah, let's try it. Let's see how that works. Go ahead.
How's it working right now as far as, is it two verses back to back?
No, it's verse and then instrumental. Verse and then we're going to do another instrumental and then repeat chorus, right?
Does it go verse, chorus?
Yeah, verse, chorus, instrumental.
Verse,
chorus, instrumental, then repeat chorus.
Is the intro going to have a, is it going to be like a full verse?
No, he's got it. Show him what the intro is, right?